Welcome, 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 Beauty and the Beat Radio. I think my thing is off. I can't even see it. You know, it needs to be underneath it. But welcome, welcome, welcome. We got Papa Michigan. I feel like you know how to go blah, 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 how they do that in the dance hall. How does it go?
Pop, pop,
pop, pop, pop. Papa Michigan. So we have the dance hall legend in the house. How are you today?
Excellent, you know.
Excellent.
Excelente.
Excelente. Thank you for sharing your time with us. Excelente. So is that Spanish? Because I saw you just came back from, was it Jalisco, Mexico on a tour out there?
Yeah, Guadalajara.
Guadalajara?
Mexico City.
How is reggae perceived or received out there?
Great.
Great?
Yeah, they love reggae.
They do?
Yeah. I don't know why, but I guess the beat has something to do with their culture.
The beat has something to do with their culture?
Yeah.
I could see that because it makes you want to dance. It's almost salsa. Almost. Yeah. I mean, it kind of makes you feel like that, right?
Yes. Yes, it does.
Do you like to dance?
I love to dance.
You love to dance? Yeah. Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Jamaica,
right.
Kingston, Jamaica.
Kingston, Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you were born into reggae. You heard that growing up, like, really? I mean, that's what I think about. I think about music. I think about food.
Yeah.
I think about, I mean, it's a lot going on in Jamaica. How was it growing up with for you music? What made you want to get into music?
Everybody in Jamaica is in music.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it's a, what? How should I put it? Everybody wants to be a singer.
Everybody?
Or a DJ.
Okay.
And if you don't want to do that, you want to be an athlete.
Okay. Oh, so soccer's big in Jamaica, right?
Soccer, and of course, everybody wants to run.
Mm-hmm.
Ever heard of Usain Bolt?
Usain Bolt, yeah, gold medalist.
Gold medalist.
Is he Kingston, Jamaica?
No.
He's from Trelawney. Okay, cool.
We have 14 parishes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Jamaica is very small.
Yes.
But we still have, you know, parishes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where he's from.
Mm-hmm.
But Kingston it's not far away. So everybody's from Kingston.
So when you started music, did you start out like in the club scene? Did you start performing? How is it when you do music there? Is it like...
Oh, I got this. Okay. I started out in the dance hall. We call
dance
it the
hall. Dance hall. Okay.
Dance hall.
Excuse me. It's different. So
dance
school me.
Dance hall. Yeah. So we started out in the dance hall.
Mm-hmm.
There was a sound system by the name of Echotone.
Okay.
There's another one by the name of Third World. That's where I get my first break. I used to sing while going to school.
Yeah, I remember that group. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
While I was going to school, I was in the dance hall, you know, doing my thing.
Mm-hmm.
Then from there, it leads on to some guy took me and my partner to the studio.
Mm-hmm.
Studio One. Studio One is like Motown.
Oh, okay.
That's where Bob Marley, all of these top artists came from.
I saw you with a picture with, was it one of the sons? Do you guys work together or do you know them? Or
yeah.
How is it? Okay.
Bob Marley had... He has a student named Tuff Gong.
Okay.
Yeah, we did a song there named One Love Jam Down.
Mm-hmm.
And we met Bob and his kids were young at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Stephen Marley, Ziggy Marley,
mm-hmm.
His wife Rita Marley,
mm-hmm.
all the Marleys, Sedella mm-hmm. Marley.
It's a lot, a big family.
Sharon Marley. So... And we were the first DJs to be graced on the 56 Opro, the Tuff Gong label, that's Bob Marley label.
Okay.
So, there's a little history there.
Do you remember your first song? What was it?
Rubber Dub Style.
Rubber Dub Style, I read that.
You know what is Rubber Dub?
No.
Rubber Dub.
That's something. Wait a minute, I feel like you should tell me, what does it mean? Is it another meaning?
No, Rubber Dub is when it can be classified in more than one. It has more than one meaning. Rubber dub is music,
mm-hmm.
but this is when it's a version. When there's just an instrument. It's instrumental.
Mm-hmm.
So that is rubber dub, and also rubber dub is like when you're in a dance or a party,
mm-hmm.
and wow. you bring a female very close to you.
Rubber dub style.
Yeah.
Rubber dub style.
Give her in a rubber dub style.
I like how
you said that.
Yeah. So when you're listening to music on your spare time, how do you get into your process when you're doing music?
everything turns me on. Not everyone, but
everything.
Musically speaking.
You're inspired by what's around you.
Yes. Okay. And it pop, classic, doesn't matter, just music. I just love music.
I had, it's in my bag. I shouldn't be moving, but I have to get this out.
Get it.
I was, sometimes we go over like hot topics and stuff, and I read something yesterday that Dr. Dre's album, he had, it's been 22 years since he released like The Chronic. And I was like, oh my gosh. So I went and I found, did you ever, you know what that is, right? You know who Dr. Dre is. Right?
I know Dr. Dre is a producer and a rapper.
Right. And so I found it and I was like, oh my gosh, this was 22 years ago. And something said, go look for it. I didn't even know if I would find it or not. But I miss like picking up CDs and stuff like that. And I saw a picture where you were like with all your vinyls. You have a lot of like records. How do you feel about this digital era right now? Like with music, like, cause on YouTube, like, you know, it's not really physical,
things evolve.
Tangible.
Things evolve.
So I'm old school for even having this still, right?
No.
22 years ago, can you believe that?
No,
this way?
Things
like,
evolve.
Yeah.
I mean, cause when we came into business, there was 8-track, which we didn't know much about. And they weren't using 8-track, and there were CDs, not CDs, cassettes.
Yeah, of course.
You know, everything just keep evolving. So we just, ain't nothing wrong with changes.
There's nothing wrong with changing. So you have children, do they perform with you as well?
Well.
Sometimes, are they musically inclined? Well, like you?
Family affair,
okay.
Mary J. Blige.
Mm-hmm.
One of my daughters, she helped pen that song.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah.
So you have writers?
Yes. Okay. And my other son is, he road manages Taurus Riley.
Okay.
That's a Jamaican singer.
Okay.
And I have another son, he sings well. I need to get him in the studio. I might have to ask your cousin here to pull him in.
Pull him in and do something.
Yeah, he lives in Atlanta and he has a good voice.
Okay.
But
He's a singer.
Mm-hmm. He wanna sing pop, not reggae.
Not reggae?
Yeah. It's all music.
Yeah. What else do you listen to? Do you listen to any other genres other than reggae?
Man, I listen.
Influenced by other people?
Of course. I listen to Stevie Wonder. I listen to everything.
You do?
I'm serious.
Okay. I believe it.
I love rap. The good ones.
The good ones. The ones you can understand?
Yeah, because some of them I don't understand a word.
I know. I feel that way too. And I'm like, is it just me? Or is it like maybe it's just going too fast or something? Like, yeah. I got to slow down. Yeah. Well, I want to get into your new single that you have. I just did a video for it. It was talking about it, Mr. Sunday Fun Day.
Put a smile on your face.
So introduce that for us so we can get it on.
Yeah, man, this new video is called Sunday Fun Day, produced by Wesley Hollywood here.
Mm-hmm.
And we filmed this in Venice Beach, and a few other locations.
I heard you had a penthouse model in there. She was acting up.
Yeah, she's a great girl.
Sunday Fun Day. Let's get into it.
Yes.
Put a smile on your face. It's Sunday. It's gonna be a fun day, yeah. Put a smile on your face. It's Sunday. It's gonna be a fun day, yeah. Everybody, you got. Wake up, everybody, it's Sunday. Oh yeah, it's gonna be a good day. Put a smile on your face, know you're worried, man. We are about to throw a party like there ain't no Monday. It's a Sunday fun day, not them. Put a smile on your face. It's Sunday. It's gonna be a fun day, yeah.
Here we go. Start dancing.
Put a smile on your face. It's Sunday. It's gonna be a fun day, yeah.
Join a party. Road 2, pour a drink into your body. Road 3, find a girl and start dancing. Road 4, you gotta do it some more. This is a Sunday fun day. Let's go.
Sha-da-da, sha-da-da.
body.
Come on,
move that booty. Yeah.
Yo, DJ, DJ, slow it down, yeah.
Put a smile on your face. It's Sunday. It's gonna be a fun day. Put a smile on your face. It's Sunday. It's gonna be a fun day.
And that's available on what, iTunes?
iTunes and all of that.
Okay, iTunes and all of that. So, and your website is papamichigan.com. Okay, so we
Facebook
can
and everything.
Facebook, everything. Papa Michigan, Instagram.
Instagram, Papa. Twitter.
Papa Michigan.
Papa Michigan.
What are your? So, how do your fans? They say.
Some say Papa. Some say Papi.
Papi. Oh.
See, I mean,
that's,
it's
the, that's the Mexican tour.
Mexican. The what tour? Is Papa Michigan?
Papa Michigan.
From school.
From school you've been called that? You've been Papa?
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah. So what was the, you also, we mentioned the tour the throughout Mexico, but you also did something in San Diego recently, the Catch a Fire?
Oh.
What was that?
I just, Catch a Fire, that's a tour that's with the Marleys.
Oh, okay.
Junior Gang, Stephen Marley.
Okay.
I didn't really perform, I was just invited. I went to the cruise.
Oh, the cruise, okay.
Yes, I was on the cruise, it just finished. The
How
tent.
Was that?
It was excellent.
It was excellent? Where did you go?
We left Miami, we went to Montego Bay.
Uh-huh.
Then from Montego Bay, we went back out in the Caribbean Sea and we party.
Uh-huh.
Then we went to Ocho Rios in Jamaica.
Ocho Rios, okay, that's where I've been. I was on a cruise, but see, I didn't really get to experience Jamaica probably like really experience it, because you know how when you go like 3 days they only let you off, and then I don't even know if we stayed overnight, it was just kind of like go
in the day.
So I would like to go and experience it, go somewhere or something.
No cruising then, huh? No, you gotta fly in.
Okay,
yeah, and enjoy it.
Okay, so what else did you perform on the cruise?
A little bit. Yeah.
Everybody does. Is it like a jam session or something? What is it like?
Well, it's like a stage show. It's like it's like a festival on water.
Mm-hmm.
It's a reggae festival on water.
Okay.
The performances start from 6:30 until about 1 o'clock at night.
Mm-hmm.
Then after that, there's a DJ that spins music until about maybe 5 a.m.
Did you ever? Because we were talking about like in Jamaica, everybody likes to DJ. Play sports or do music. Did you ever DJ as well? Because you have a lot of music. And yeah. I saw you with a lot of vinyl, so I was like,
I produce.
So you have to get inspired by all the music.
I produce a lot of different artists.
Okay, who have you produced for?
There's one that's going to get a Grammy. His name is Luciano.
Okay.
I produce him also.
Okay.
I produce George Nooks, Half Pint, a lot of different, many artists in the reggae fraternity I produce.
Okay. What do you like to write about? Because you said everything is inspired, you're inspired by everything. So what type of things do you like to write about?
Social. I like to write about social things. And I was told I should write more about love.
Oh, yeah, why not? Love is universal.
Yeah, so I'm beginning.
We need more love. Yeah. What do you think about Donald Trump saying, do you ever watch any of the Republican, what was going on this week? That Republican conference. Every time I turn on the news, it's like he has this little face, and it's hard to take him seriously because he's doing this. You know how, like, if you're posing for a picture, that's what Donald Trump looks like when he's talking to me.
He's a good performer.
I think he feels like he's on stage, and he is.
He performs well.
Okay.
Man, if he wins, what can I say? The people have to vote him in, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Somebody has to vote him.
But I'm not going to get involved in politics.
So you don't talk about only social, no politics. We're not bashing him. I'm just.
I didn't say you're bashing him.
Oh, yeah.
But
yeah.
I kind of keep myself away from certain things.
Okay.
I have my own way of, analyzing him.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all of them.
Right. I get it.
Even our Jamaican politics.
Mm-hmm. It's very different in Jamaica for the politics versus here, right?
Yes. America is only 2 terms. Mm-hmm. You can stay. Mm-hmm. In Jamaica, you can stay as long as you want to, if the people vote for you.
Kind of like how in England.
Britain. Okay. That's where we're from. That's the system.
Okay, same thing.
Same
Parliament,
system.
Is that what it's called?
Parliament.
Ah, I know a little something. I heard somebody, a little bird, told me. So, what's next for you? You got the Sunday fun day. I know I have a t-shirt in the mail coming, right?
Sure
do. Okay, cool. So, and then you have another song that you have. What was the name of it?
High Grade. Yeah.
It's about that high grade.
It's about that high grade that is legal right now.
It's like tea time at 420.
Tea time 420.
Ah.
The song is big also in Colombia and all over.
Have you been to Colombia?
I was supposed to go to Colombia and I didn't go because of the cruise.
Okay.
I think the cruise was more important.
Yeah. So where are you performing next?
Next, I'll be in Jamaica.
You'll be in Jamaica?
Yeah, then I'll be back to San Diego.
Okay.
Then I'll be doing 3 shows in Arizona.
Okay.
So, we're on the move.
You're on the move. So it's like kind of year long, you just tour,
yes,
perform your music. You got it on iTunes. What, Spotify, all the distribution. Look up Papa Michigan.
Yeah.
Okay. Is there any artists that you haven't worked with that you want to work with, producing wise or, you know, song wise?
Stevie Wonder.
That would be good.
That'd be good.
Yeah.
He loves reggae.
Yeah, and he just has a soulful voice. It seems like, yes, he could blend your styles.
Yeah.
We put it out there. Stevie, call us. Papa Michigan needs to get on.
Stevie, link up. I met him once at Samash.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's cool.
Sunmesh.
Sam.
Oh, Sam Ash, the Guitar Center.
Yeah, we took pictures.
Okay.
He's good. But I would like to work with some rappers, though, seriously. Like, okay, to fuse the thing.
Yeah.
I mean, rap came from reggae.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. And we're saying the same thing because we're the same people.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing that you feel, the same thing we feel.
Right, expressing yourself.
Yes. So okay. I would love to work with a few rappers.
Okay. Well, we got a rapper here when your alter ego, Dennis the Menace.
That's Dennis the Menace?
Yes.
Respect Dennis the Menace.
Yeah. Yes. So we're going to get into your next song and then we're going to talk to Mr. Dennis L.A. White. Hi, welcome to Beauty and the Beat.
Yeah, man. High grade for them.
High grade for them? High grade for everybody.
Yeah, man. High grade for everybody, right?
Okay. All right, let's play that. You got that ready?
This is for y'all ganja man. I'm a dingo and ganja woman. I want you put up on the one. I'm a dingo, bitch. Right now I need a little cooperation to justify the situation. Babylon attack me ganja plantation. So right now me need a little information. So what about legalization? The high grade make we have a celebration. Light up the chalice in Selassie High Palace. Yes it is, I original Michigan. High grade, how we me have in me bugger. We all are the human, them and all of the man. High grade, me are the ganja man. Original DJ Papa Michigan. High grade, but you can't know me plan. Me no wine farm, I go tell Babylon about me high grade. Continue the song. Well, this smoke by doctors and lawyers, presidents and prime ministers. How me know? Then check me pon me corner. Ask Bill Clinton and Barack Obama. Ask me principal and me teachers. Plus me 2 soldier friend them. Said that me fi lend them. Me tell them seminar then them. Them a fi buy cause me not trust none of them. Me high grade. When me have in a me bag. Fi all of the human them and all of the man. High grade. Me a the ganja man. Original DJ Papa Michigan. High grade. But you can't know me plan. Me no wine farm. I go tell Babylon about me high grade. Continue the song. It name La 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 La. Welcome the ganja man. La 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 La. Welcome the ganja man. Well it look as if me get the corporation from the people of the United Nations. Want to meet me pon me plantation. Said them need some ganja education. Well herb can improve the economy. Medicinal cannabis watch millions a make. Who nah join, what a tragedy. California legalize it properly. Colorado doing it properly. Well Jamaica we have to do it quickly.
revenue for running out the country. Tell the prime minister fi think wisely about time. And when me have it on me bugger, fi all of the human, them and all of the man. I agree, me a the ganja man. Original DJ, Papa Michigan. I agree, but you can't know me plan. Me no want farm and go tell Babylon about me. I agree, continue the song. Well, this smoke by doctors and lawyers.
Uh-oh, rubber dub style.
Oh, my God.
High grade. Hey.
High grade, ganja.
High grade.
That's your crew?
That's our crew.
Big up the crew.
Big up the crew. They like that. They outside dancing.
You have to, reggae has something to do with you.
It has something. It makes you move your...
You have to move.
You have to?
You have to.
I was moving.
I saw you.
You saw me? I was grooving. Well, we're going to check you out. We're going to follow you. I want everybody to follow Papa Michigan on all social media platforms. Check out YouTube, mm-hmm. Papa Michigan. Look it up.
Facebook.
Get Twitter. Twitter.
Instagram.
Talk to everybody. They're going to be talking to y'all. I heard that. Hi, yeah. Great. They're going to be calling you.
They should. They should.
Ah, well, we love it. Well, thank you for coming. Thank you for sharing your time and your music. We loved it. We're going to continue to play it and listen to it. And we're going to go to a commercial right now, and then we're going to come with Mr. Dennis L.A. Why, you ready for us?
Always.
Yeah, man, so let me tell you, thanks for inviting me.
Mm-hmm.
Inviting reggae music on your show.
Of course.
Because when you invite me, you invite Jamaica.
Okay, well, welcome Jamaica.
You don't know.
Kingston. Where's the blah, blah, blah?
Yeah, that is when the music's sweet, you know.
That makes it.
Yeah, we have a forward. That means it. Come again. Rewind.
I like that when they say that.
Liquid mean rewind. All and pull up, so we rewind. All right. So, enough respect, enough love to your fans also that tune in to you.
Mm-hmm.
And thanks for the invite.
I thank you for
respect
coming.
And to all of my... Latino, mucho respeto. Yo soy Papa Michigan, excelente para siempre. Remember.
Beauty and the Beat Radio, let them know where you at.
Yeah, man, right now we're on Beauty and the Beat. Every time.
Thank you, Papa Michigan, we appreciate you.
Respect.
Okay, so we're going to go to a people and then commercial, please. Switch it up.
Are you a diabetic? Need some energy? Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Need to quench your thirst? Try Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, the only energy drink named suitable for diabetics by the American Diabetic Association. And it's now available with no calories, no carbs, no sugar, and no fat, and a smooth, natural blend of energy, vitamins, and minerals. Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink is the healthiest, best-tasting energy drink around. For more information and online ordering with free shipping, please visit hiphopbev.com. Remember, Pitbull Sugar-Free Energy Drink, suitable for diabetics, great for everyone.
He's coming back. Hi, welcome back. You done went from hood to Hollywood.
You know, I was hood on y'all a little bit because I'm in Cali.
Right.
You know, West Coast.
West Coast Raiders on. We might really get the Raiders out here. They said by the 16th of January, it's going to be official if we know if they're either Carson or Inglewood or at all.
That'd be dope.
Feel about that? You watch football? You a football fan?
I'm a Patriots fan.
Okay.
Patriots. All day. You know what I mean?
So you from, that's cold weather. That's yeah, what New yeah. England is what? Is that?
Boston, yeah.
Boston, okay, cool.
Yeah.
I was just making sure before I said it. Like, I don't know. But I know who New England Patriots are, of course.
Yeah, so it would be nice to have a team out here. You know, mm-hmm. LA deserves it.
We deserve it. I mean, we're tired of no football. It's hard for me to even get into. I enjoy football,
mm-hmm.
like when it's a good game.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I enjoy like Super Bowls and stuff like that because it's exciting. You know what's going on.
Yeah.
But like because we don't have our own team, it's hard for me to just, you know, get into
it. Rally behind the troops.
Like, I mean, I support, I mean, I don't know. I ain't really into it this year. Just like, you know, basketball, Kobe. This is last year.
I went to the game last night.
You did? Every time I watch it, it's like.
And the Staples Center was crazy.
Amazing.
It was lit, yeah.
They was happy. They was like, he's on.
Yeah.
Oh, I hate to see Kobe go, but he's, I mean, a lot of people don't even get to play 20 years.
So he's, you know, especially for one team. That's really unheard of.
Yeah, for one, he did. Yeah. He got drafted by Philly and came straight here.
He got drafted by Charlotte Hornets.
Was it? Okay.
Yeah, Charlotte Hornets.
But he never even played a game. Okay. Wow. So I know your time is so busy. It's Christmas holiday season, so thank you for making the time to spend it with us.
Thank you for having me.
Did you grow up in, you were born and raised here, but you grew
I was
up in,
born in San Bernardino.
Okay.
But so I was only there a couple months, and then I moved to Northern California, Fairfield, Susan. My father was in the military. Then we moved to the East Coast.
Which was North Carolina.
Fayetteville.
Oh, Vietnam. Who was in here that was saying that one day? Why do y'all call it Vietnam?
Because it's like Vietnam. It's like, you know, because of the military base, Fort Bragg and Pope Air Force Base.
Okay, that's why.
We were, you know, we had a lot of military influence, and Fayetteville is gangster. You know what I'm saying? People don't really respect it because it's the South, but, you know, if you ever been and lived in Fayetteville, you respect the gangsterness and the hustle of it.
The gangster. Oh,
yeah.
Like, that's why you gotta give it your gangster. I feel like I need my hoodie on. Like, keep it on. So Fayetteville, but speaking of North Carolina, there was an incident that came up with you and your girlfriend, either at that time or maybe current girlfriend still, like, where you guys were racially profiled?
Yeah, it was in South Carolina.
Okay, so
it
you
was were... with an associate.
Okay, so I'm sorry, like, I don't know,
yeah,
you know.
Nah.
That's
why
I'm asking. It wasn't
a... with an associate, not a girlfriend.
Okay, excuse me.
Yeah.
A female.
A female.
You guys were sightseeing, rolling, you know, going through, South Carolina.
South Carolina, near Myrtle Beach, and we got pulled over, she's never seen cotton before, so it was a cotton field, so we pulled over to take pictures. And
what is real, when you see cotton, if you touch it, what does it feel like? Does it feel like cotton how we see it, or it has to be processed differently?
Nah, it feels, it's fluffy. It's, if you ever get a chance to see cotton and understand what we've been through, like our heritage, it's prickly, it's hard, you know, you prick your fingers, there's all these things coming out of it. I can't imagine doing that every day. You know what I'm saying?
How a rose stem?
Similar, yeah. And it's beautiful, though. If you see it, you know, it's...
I've seen
it's
pictures, but I mean, to see it in person, I think it would be probably more amazing.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. So, you know, living in North Carolina, I never experienced it living in Cali, of course.
Right.
But living in North Carolina, you know, you see that and you just, you know, realize what our ancestors went through. Having, you know,
to do that every day, all day,
forcefully to pick cotton. It's crazy. So, you know, we were not forced, just looking at it, and we got accosted by funk ass cop, and you know, handcuffed and detained and all this other dumb stuff. So
because you were looking at cotton.
Yeah, you know, but South Carolina is famous for being racially unequal.
Okay.
You know, so. The governor of South Carolina, she called me, apologized, but you know, it's never enough. So I started an organization called the MORF, Movement Opposing Racial Profiling and Harassment.
To eradicate racial
profiling. This is, you know, give knowledge and to help those and get the word out and the awareness, because a lot of stuff happens in this country that, you know, we hear about the Trayvon Martins and stuff, but there's a lot of people that get racially profiled, harassed, and goes unnoticed. Mm-hmm. You know, so just trying to get the word out and get the visibility out about it.
I think the climate now is more receptive to at least listening and being heard for those that have been, like, but it's still, like, even today, I think, this week in the news, they're starting the Baltimore.
Yeah. The case,
yeah. Or the, you know, so it's still a lot of work to be done. Let's get into you as a performer, actor, and all that. So, did you start getting to acting like young while you were here? Did they plant the seed being in LA and seeing all this Hollywood?
It had nothing to do with being in LA because I never lived in LA.
Okay, so
I never, my mother.
She was a performer.
Yeah, she sings, mm-hmm. she writes, and she plays, you know, piano, organ, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So, and my father could sing too. But I always was, you know, playing sports.
Okay.
And doing plays and singing, okay. and Black History Month, I was on tour. Like, you know, so I was doing a Dream Deferred at every community center and stuff like that. So,
okay.
I was always involved in the arts.
Okay.
And so, music, singing, dance, all the other stuff.
It just kind of came with
you. Yeah. So, it's just part of who I am. I can.
You're like, yeah, I can.
Yeah.
You're like, of course. Like, what you doing?
Nah, not of course, because a lot of people say they can sing.
But no, I mean, with your mom was nominated for a Grammy as well, right?
Yeah.
So what, she toured with, what, Rick James?
No. I toured with Rick James.
Oh, okay. You toured. What was
Rick
that?
Rick James, bitch.
What?
Yeah, when he did his reunion tour, I had a group called Black 'Em Out.
Okay.
A dude named Craig Ellis. And, okay. And we were his opening act.
Wow, what was that? What was it like touring? Because Rick James is off the hood. Everything I've seen, I don't know.
Everything you see, believe it.
Really?
He is, wow. Yo, it was crazy because...
And what was his girl? Who was his girlfriend?
You talking about Tina Marie?
Tina Marie, she's passed too. Awful.
Crazy, people falling off like flies. Man. But yeah, Rick was cool, man. Like he... When we first kind of met, he was like really in competition with us, and we were like,
"You were cold as ice." That was his song. I used to love that song. I'm sorry.
Yeah, he was always competing. Like, you're an icon. We can't compete, you know.
Right.
But he, you know, it was a respect thing, and we became really, really close and really cool.
Okay.
It was amazing. But my mom, she wrote for a gospel group called Wilmington Chester.
Okay.
Wilmington Chester, John Key, has got a lot of gospel artists. Mm-hmm. And so the title song she wrote for Wilmington Chester's album that was nominated for a Grammy, she wrote that. So, I mean, I was always around in music, you know, always doing that. And then, like I said, sports.
And sports?
Yeah.
What sports did you play?
I played baseball.
Oh, baseball.
Basketball.
Oh, everything.
Played a little football, but mostly baseball, you know. So mm-hmm. it was sports, entertainment, and trying to stay out of trouble.
Travel in South Carolina,
North Carolina.
Yeah. Okay, so you released what, The Wonderful World of Dennis? What was that like? Because that was 2001, and now you're still doing music, correct?
Yeah.
So what was that like, and how have you grown as an artist, like up until now, with musically?
That was cool because I did it out of, I was living in D.C. at the time.
Oh wow!
And we just, I mean, I wanted to just do whatever mm-hmm. and just do. Everything I wanted to say, everything I felt,
mm-hmm.
and we had, you know, it's a, you know, I'm singing on it, I'm rapping on it, doing a lot of different things on it, and it was a good album. We hit the Billboard charts, and we had a lot of notoriety
mm-hmm.
as far as like underground and stuff like that. Then like my acting kind of just took precedent, you know, my hosting and stuff like that. But still, you know, I still do music. I'm working with an artist now. That I'm managing is called Anthem Brown.
Okay.
And he's a kid, he's 18 years old. So I just directed mm-hmm. His first video called Back to Back. Yeah.
So you're an actor, you produce, because I saw you produce something, a series called Dreams or co-produce or something?
Well, yeah, I was on that, yeah. Okay. And then I just produced something with the Hodge Twins.
Mm-hmm.
We did something at the Playboy Mansion a couple weeks ago.
Who are the Hodge? Are those the ones that did Menace?
No, the Hodge Twins, they're fitness gurus.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, do you do fitness? You know what? I've seen you, like, in pictures. Like, you have so many looks, but I think that's the key to being a great actor.
Yeah.
Is that I was like, is that him? Like, that's him, too. It's like, I could see 10 things. I mean, even size-wise, I'm like, was that for a role? You look so different.
Yeah.
Then it was when you was real mean. I said, now, that's a Dennis the Menace, and this is Dennis L.A. Why is it L.A.? Why you wanted to, what is that, what does the L.A. mean?
People always think it's like because I'm Hollywood and I'm an actor, but there's no really big story behind it. That's my middle initials.
Is it really? Yeah. Okay, you like
Dennis Lamar Allen White.
Oh,
that's
okay.
It. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So when I first got into Screen Actors Guild,
mm-hmm.
they billed me as that, and I was trying to get it changed
mm-hmm.
For the movie I did, The Brave One,
mm-hmm.
with Jodie Foster, and they wouldn't let me change. I was trying to change it to Dennis the Menace, and it was like, you gotta go through all these. So I just kept it Dennis L.A. White.
Oh, okay.
It just works.
I didn't know they couldn't let you. They trying to be.
I mean, it's a lot of paperwork that had to be done and everything,
right.
But
for the signature,
yeah.
When she gets on.
But you know, it's my name, Dennis Lamar Allen White.
Wow. So you also did something with Was it the video games where your voice was on? Yeah. How did you get involved with that? Because that was really big. The Def Jam series. Remember they had a series?
Yeah, the Def Jam Vendetta.
Okay, what
that
was that
about? Cool. Well, okay, so I used to host a Fuse Television. Mm-hmm. I had a TV show on there. And
The Weeknd was
it? No, it was called Fuse Television. What? I can't remember the name of the show that we had.
That's big because that was a long time. Like, you know, it wasn't a lot of people doing that now.
Yeah, I was the first African-American host on there.
Oh, right.
And so... it was called Daily Download. That's what it was called.
Okay.
So
it would be like, what was the show?
It was called My TRL.
Okay, yeah.
So, you know, we had a live TV show every day. We had millions of viewers. We had audience.
Like Carson Daly up in here.
You know what I mean?
You know what I mean?
So we had Kevin Lyles, who was VP of Def Jam.
Okay.
And when they were doing the video game. And so we played on the air. And he said, if I beat him, he made me a character.
Wow.
And I beat him. I don't know how. I don't play video games, man. So
he let you beat him. He wanted you.
I don't think he let me because he was kind of pissed that I beat him. Mm. But yeah, I beat him, and I became. So he made me Baxter on the video game, which is like the bottom, like the first person ass you whoop to practice is me. So nah, but it's honor. And then I did a Warriors video game on some other stuff, and just, you know, just every facet of the industry I want to learn, I want to touch and experience and expound upon.
That's excellent. I want to get into, you brought us something, I don't know what it is. What?
Not yet.
You don't have it?
Not yet.
Oh, okay.
We're going to let it marinate first.
Oh, we're going to marinate it. Okay. Well, I did want to get familiar. There is like your most known, like, I mean, you have almost 40 films or things to your credit in addition to producing, and now you're saying directing, working with other artists. But I was going to play a trailer that was from Notorious, because we know you as the D-Rock character, Damian Butler. And so I wanted people to get familiar if they don't know, you know, we got Dennis up in here, and I want them to know, what was that like in Notorious playing that role? Because that was pretty big. It was a big movie. It's an iconic. You're playing someone that was still alive.
Yeah.
You know, I think, did he go to jail again with Lil' Kim? Was that the,
that's the one? Yeah, he's the one that shoot out.
Yeah, okay. So he's a wild guy. He's a wild guy, you know, gun-toting, all this stuff. What was it like getting into that character? Because you're not from New York, but I mean, I got the sense when I saw the film, like, you know, everybody in there was born and raised in Brooklyn or something. Yeah. So what was that like playing Notorious and getting the news and all that?
Well, as far as Brooklyn concerned, like, I feel like I'm a adopted Brooklyn kid. You know what I mean? Like, Brooklyn is my home. I love Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
I lived there for almost 10 years.
Oh, okay. Then that's why.
I just kind of, you know, I feel Brooklyn. So to have opportunity to be part of an icon, Biggie Smalls, I was a big fan of Biggie. You know, he was just one of my favorite rappers. So.
What's your favorite Biggie song?
Probably Warning.
Okay.
Warning.
Is that who the hell is this? Cause me at 6:46
in the morning.
Let me
find out.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I mean, you know, and suicide tendencies, you know, but I have a lot of Biggie joints that I love, but just to be part of his legacy and to have opportunity to audition for it, I didn't know about Damian Butler and before D-Rock, before the film. I had no idea who he was.
Right.
So when I did the research, I found out so much about him, how important he was in Biggie's life.
Mm-hmm.
And
he kind of co-managed him unofficially, right?
Yeah, you know, he was his man that watched out for him.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, he was like in the clubs and in New York, like, he was, you know, people respected him. You know, I have a lot of stories people told me about D-Rock.
Mm-hmm.
And so while we were filming, he was incarcerated. And so I didn't get a chance to talk to him before, but I did a lot of research and had transcripts, and I had a homeboy that was locked up, so I went to go kick it with him and just a whole
just
research.
As an actor.
And so when he came home, we met up. He was with Puff at One Oak in New York, and we met up, like, the premiere was like on Thursday. I met him like on that Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
And
did
so,
he come?
Yeah, he came. He was a little nervous too.
What did he say about your acting?
Like, he enjoyed it.
Okay,
he enjoyed
cool.
it.
That's
you
good.
Know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I respect him. Mm-hmm. You know, he's still rocking with Puff and everything. He's a great stand up dude. I have nothing but respect and honor for him.
So what does D-Rock, because was he Little Kim? I mean, I've heard different stories. Yeah. I didn't like research who D-Rock was.
Yeah.
But I know that, like, I remember hearing something that he was like managing Kim or the Junior Mafia crew, and then they might have dated or something. So I mean, what is he doing now, or what was he? What was his role?
He was a stand-up dude.
Just a stand-up guy.
Stand-up street dude.
Stand-up street dude.
That had their back.
Their back, okay.
And whatever needed to be done, he did. And so right now, like I said, he rocks with Puffy.
Mm-hmm.
He has his clothing line called Invisible Bully.
Oh, okay.
And he's doing a lot of different things. You know, mm-hmm. he's a behind-the-scenes type of dude.
Okay, and that's what's up. So let's get into... I think you're in this trailer. That's why I pulled it. So let's play the trailer from Notorious so we can see. You had like a high top and all that.
Yeah, it was lace front weave, high top fade.
Did that? Was it for real?
Nah, real tall. I mean, I had hair, but it was a lace front to make it high top and everything.
Get out.
And it was crazy because they didn't really want that. They wanted me to do the baldy, but when I look at the pictures, I saw how D-Rock had a high top fade. I'm like, I gotta do him justice.
Mm-hmm.
So we battled, and me and the hairstylist, like, we was gonna do it. They don't like it, we take it off, but it worked.
It worked. Well, let's get into Notorious, the trailer from Notorious, the biopic.
Brooklyn, we did it.
I know that you understand, not a fool or a loser, I'm a one man.
W Wallace rappers are demolished.
Bro, what are you doing? You saying your prayers?
Praying that God teaches you how to dock.
Please, you ain't got nothing I haven't seen.
If the heavy set one with the big gun and the sweet tooth.
You won't end up like those worthless bums you hang with, don't you see that?
One of you is going down for carrying an illegal firearm. You decide who.
This music you got going on, it don't come around every day. When you make it, we all make it.
If I don't make it?
Not going back on the block. Not if I take this bid for your ass.
It's my life, you feel me? Tell Puff I'm down with chasing the dream. Whatever he want me to do, I'm in.
Yeah, he got sex appeal like LL?
Yeah, a little bigger than that.
What, like Harry D?
He a little darker than that.
Yo, he look like Wesley Snipes?
He ain't Wesley.
The West Coast, they got Snoop, they got Dre. The East Coast, they just waiting for somebody to fill that void.
Puff, maybe in the right hands, I could be one of the greatest.
It was all a dream. I used to read Word Up magazine.
Are you a bad guy trying to be good?
You seen anybody?
Or a good guy trying to be bad?
I'm someone trying to make you laugh.
Whatever you say, Big Papa.
I let my tape rock to my tape pop.
What kind of grown-ass man calls himself Puffy?
By the time you're 21, I'll make you into a millionaire. Just keep an eye out for the media, for the public, and for your fake-ass friends.
Give it up!
I'm sorry, Faye. I just want to come home.
Tell him he needs to visit his daughter every once in a while.
Set me up!
Be careful, son. Nobody's invincible.
Let's change the world, Big.
Can't change the world unless we change ourselves.
That was good. Even seeing that now, it makes me want to go see the movie again.
And it brings back so many memories.
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know, the scene in which he actually got killed. And we shot that. We shot that here in L.A.
Okay.
Peter Peterson Automotive. And
you saw how they've totally redone that?
Yeah.
It looks weird. Not just weird, but just different.
Being on that street, that same street where he got killed,
mm-hmm.
it was very ominous. And it was just people were crying and just knowing that.
Something.
Right in that same spot, he was murked. You know what I'm
mm-hmm.
saying? So it's just crazy. And then also the scene of how, before the movie came out, we didn't know what it was gonna look like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've done movies where it's like, oh my God, this movie is gonna be incredible. And you mm-hmm. see it like this, it's horrible.
Right.
But when we had the the screening for Just the Actors, it was not a dry eye in the building. Everybody cried, and everybody was emotional and proud, you know. And to this day, you know, the love is still there. People still love this movie. I still get so much back from it, and just fans, and it's just, it's dope, man. It's gonna be one of those movies that's gonna go down in history as one of the greatest hip hop movies.
I think so too, cause you've worked with a lot of people, but would you say this would be one of your most memorable, like, or cause I mean, you've had, like, when we're talking about 40 films, and this is one of me. I mean, you've been on TV shows, so what would this be, one of the most memorable or one?
Well, yeah, it's one of, it's in the top. Mm-hmm. You know, everything I do, I appreciate it because I put my all into it.
Mm-hmm.
So, whether it's an independent film, whether it's a TV show, whether it's Parenthood, you know, whatever, it's all those projects I put my all into it. So they all bring back special memories for me.
Speaking of Parenthood, that was on NBC. You had a recurring role on there, and that was actually based on a film, and then it turned into a TV series. Mm-hmm. So now we have Notorious that you've done, and then we just, did you see Straight Outta Compton?
Yeah, I did.
So, I mean, it's kind of on the same level as Notorious as far as just, you know, highlighting, you know, that era of, well, not even that era, it was kind of before Biggie, but that era of music. Do you think, that VH1 has something called The Breaks coming out, I think it's a made-for-TV movie about, like, hip-hop or whatever. Do you think we're seeing more of hip-hop and music, or the diversity in music, and how, on television or on film?
Yeah, well, being black right now is hot.
It is.
You know what I'm saying? It's hot right now being black. So, yeah, there's a lot of, with Empire, Power,
yeah.
You know, yeah, my homie Amari and Aturi, you know, we was on Punk.
Yeah,
I punked her a couple months ago. But,
What, she's so surprised. Like, how do y'all do? Like, it's like everybody gets involved and it's just
yeah,
like,
it was though. We got it good. But, it's just, you know, hip hop has been a staple for a long time, and so now people are really looking at it and seeing that it's viable and it's making money. You know, Straight Outta Compton just did
numbers. So
crazy numbers, and I'm so proud of them for that. You know, I feel like we opened doors for Straight Outta Compton, and 8 Mile opened doors for us. You know what I'm saying?
True.
So, you know, it's, as long as you put out good product, you know, you can't go wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so the Empires and the Blackish and all that, I'm happy for everybody.
I'm glad to hear that. Also, like, speaking of just all the films, TV shows, and things you've been involved with, you also have something that you do. It's a workshop. Is it called Act Like You Know?
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that and what you do, because that's not just, like, in one city. You go from city to city and do workshops. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I've been doing that for, like, about five years now.
Okay.
And just really, you know, helping actors, aspiring actors, get the knowledge to get into the game, and help them, you know, just build who they are as an actor. And so, I do it all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
I just got back from Houston doing one.
Mm-hmm.
I was in Detroit with Carl Payne, you know, Cole from Martin.
Oh yeah, I just saw him somewhere. Where are we at tomorrow? She like, what? Carl Payne. Oh, the what was the place on Melrose? The Comedy Store. The Improv. I saw him at the Improv like a Monday ago, sort of.
That's my dude.
Hey, Carl Payne.
Yeah, CP.
CP.
And then I'll be in North Carolina doing one
next
month. And I think I might do one here in L.A. the end of January.
How about that time? When is it? The end of
January 30th? Yeah. I'll give you details on it.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
So just really, you know, because when I got in the game, everything I learned was pretty much like on-the-job experience. I didn't have anyone to say, yo, you do this, you do that. This is how you structure your resume. This is how you do this. This is how you prepare for an audition. This is, you know, I didn't know that. No, I just found out.
I didn't either. I'm going to share a story, which is funny, but it was something like my friend was working with John Singleton at the time, and she was like, you should come and audition. He's holding this. And it was like, I didn't realize how political it is, too, because there's casting agents that want the credit for casting anyone that they're doing. So if someone calls you in to audition, it's like, well, who is that and whatever. So it's like, well, do you have your sides? And, you know, I'm coming from the restaurant industry or whatever. I'm like, sides? Like, I'm thinking greens, remember? Like, it was so, but when I say that it's such a learning curve that until you really know the business. So I think it's excellent that you have workshops for people that just are really green and don't know but really want to get into it because they really are trying to get into the business.
Yeah, and I also do private coaching as well for a lot of celebrities.
Mm-hmm.
Just to get them ready for their audition or for their roles in the movies and stuff like that. So just really helping.
Who's your acting coach? Shoot, you getting all this coaching. You have a phone caller. We're going to save that answer, but we're going to talk to him. Put your headphones on.
All right.
Welcome to Beauty and the Beat. Thank you for calling in. We got Dennis L.A. right in the building. Who's this?
Yeah, my name is Michael Bowie. I'm calling you from Raleigh, North Carolina.
Oh, welcome, North Carolina.
What's up, Mike?
How are you?
I do. For Dennis, listen, I've been to a couple of your workshops, and you impart so much knowledge when you do what you do. I was wondering, students, what would you say is one or two of the most earth-shattering realizations they come to when you teach them what you do, what really turns their acting career around or gets them moving in the right direction? What would you say has been a couple of really key things?
Wow, that's a great question. you know what? I think that when they realize that they have the talent and that the power is in them and not in the casting director, not in the producer, not in the director, that they hold the power. Because a lot of times we go in auditions as, oh, boss, oh, master, this, please give me this role, Lord Jesus, instead of saying, yo, you know, you should be honored that I'm in here to audition for you.
Uh-huh.
So that's what I try. I try to empower my students to know that it's all about them. I don't care how good of a director you are, how good of a producer you are. If you don't have any actors, the project won't happen. So that's the biggest thing. And also being prepared. You know, a lot of times we feel that I look good so I can act. Or, you know, I'm smart and I can act. No, you have to prepare yourself. So I think those are the two biggest things.
Well, can I share with your host and with your listening audience something you really helped me with?
Okay.
Dennis, I actually took a couple of soul lessons with Dennis, and well, more than that, really. But he recognized right away. He watched some things I was in, and he said, "You know what you need, Mike? You need, you know, you get in certain roles where you're serious or you're the kind of heavy guy. But let's teach you how to be light and humorous." And the first thing he did was give me a script where I had to struggle through learning how to be light and to inflect my voice and interact with my scene partner in a humorous and a lighthearted way that brought out the funny. So Dennis is, I have to tell you, in my experience, he is so insightful and discerning about what his student needs when he does his workshops. I just thought I would bring that out.
Thank you so much, Mike. You know, a lot of times as actors, we get into our heads and we're so focused on getting the words right and everything that our face gets contorted and we're all focused on in the scene and not in the scene. We're in our heads and not in the scene. So, and I've seen so much growth from you, man. I thank you so much for calling in and I owe you that money that's me.
Hey man, it's all true. I ain't gonna give nothing that ain't true.
I know.
All right, well, it's nice talking with you, and I hope to see you sometime soon.
No doubt.
Okay, great. Yes. Well, thank you, North Carolina, and thank you for calling Beauty and the Beat. Bye bye. Okay,
that's great.
That was excellent. So they're really learning. Often, you know, when I speak to a lot of people, they're like, "Oh, I don't." You know, it's not about like kind of giving back to the same industry that you're in. So it's good to hear that they really appreciate your workshops and are really learning something from it and taking something away from it.
You have to give back, you know.
I think you could probably, you probably learn from your own workshops.
I do. You know, and I always feel like if you ain't, if you're not doing what I want to do, how can you teach me?
Right.
There's a lot of people out here that are teaching acting who are horrible. Mm-hmm. Or who just been background actors. Mm-hmm. Or you might have went to school and got a degree, but you never been on television. You never been in films. Mm-hmm. So how can you teach me to do what I want to do when you can't even do it yourself?
Or answer the questions that you might really have about real act, like doing
real
on the
situations.
Set. Real situations.
I've been in almost in every capacity. Mm-hmm. I've been a stunt double. I was a stunt double for 50 Cent in Righteous Kill.
Oh.
I've been a PA. I've been a background actor. I've been a series regular with Spike Lee and Miracles Boy. I've done a lot of different facets of this entertainment field. So I learned from that, and I teach my students because I want them to be better.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to work with them. And if you're not good, I can't work with you.
That's right.
Yeah, I can't hire you, put it that way.
I like that. I like that a lot. What you mentioned Spike Lee, it made me think of, what does he have, Chirac out right now? Have you seen that?
I haven't seen it.
I haven't seen it either. It's getting, why are you shaking your head?
I heard it's trash.
I don't know. I mean, I've heard both that it was trash. I heard it was cool. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? And you know,
it's such a sensitive topic. We talk about. I mean, yesterday we just had the big LAUSD thing with, you know, just threatening and feeling terrorism and feeling. Well, I mean, it was, but it was until they found out it was not a credible or whatever you call it, credible threat. Then they had to do what they had to do. So, I mean, you had like 700,000 kids out of school.
They've been doing this type of stuff every year. It's nothing new to me, so that's why I was just saying this.
Okay. It ended up being a hoax, which is good, and they're back in school today. But, I mean, speaking of Chirac, there's so much going on in Chicago. I think that's why he did it.
Well, I think that people thought that it was going to be either the hood film about the hood in Chirac or how to eradicate it, but he took a different approach to it, and I haven't seen it, so I can't really speak upon it if it's great or if it's horrible. I can't because I haven't seen it, but that's what the response I'm hearing. So you know, I might check it out.
Like I want to check it out just because I want to see what his thought process was about the Chicago situation and so much going on there.
Yeah.
And I mean, I just want to see it. I feel like Spike Lee is a great director. We had Ruth Carter on the show. She's one of the costumers. She's been like working with him for, you know, Ruth Carter.
That name sounds familiar. I probably know her by face.
She worked on Selma and a few other things.
But yeah,
I mean, I just think that he's a great director. So I would still like to see it. I don't know exactly what it's about, so I don't have anything to like add to this.
Yeah, I respect his attention to detail.
Yes, that part. So you've worked with Cuba Good. You've worked with so many. I don't even know. The list would be like blah 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 blah. Is there anyone that someone that's in delving into directing and producing yourself that you haven't worked with that you might want to? That like when you see something, like I want to work with them.
I would love to work with Joaquin Phoenix. And I would just love to kind of like spar with him on camera and also kind of direct him and see his thought process. Who else? Jeffrey Wright. I think he's an incredible actor. And so there's a lot, man. There's a lot. I mean, you know, of course Denzel, you know, because he's that dude. I would love to spar with him on camera.
What do you think about, I'm looking forward to Will Smith's Concussion movie. My friend is married to an NFL player that's retired, and he's been affected by that same situation. He's part of that lawsuit, so it's very, like, you know, it's like, I've seen what she's gone through. He lost his hearing totally, and just seeing her go through that process, that it's like a real thing that a lot of people don't recognize. You talked about NFL when we came in, but I mean, it's a real thing. They're really risking their lives every week when they go out there and play. So, I mean, he took a...
This is how I feel about that. I mean, when you get into the situation, you know what it is.
You do.
You know it's a contact sport. And I don't know if they need to pad the helmets better or whatever, but it's contact sport. And you're getting paid a certain amount of money to endure that pain. So I'm not saying that it's right for them to have concussions and what happens, but... You know, that's part of what
they need to have the protective equipment. They just need to be prepared for what it is. I mean, everybody that wants to play is really playing because they want to play.
Yeah.
But maybe they're protected. Okay.
I mean, a lot of athletes get hurt with non-contact. They tear their ACL by cutting. You know, so you know, when you're an athlete, that stuff you have to endure. You know, I'm not saying that they should suck it up, but I don't know what the answer is. But it's football, man.
It's football. It's a sport. Okay, so you brought something else. What are you, like, is this music that we're about to get into?
This is a video the video I directed for my artist, Anthem Brown.
For Anthem Brown.
Yeah,
so
it's
what
my
are
first
you...
video that I directed, actually, so.
Yeah. What do you like to listen to? Like, what inspires you creatively with music? I think I asked Papa Michigan over there what he said, everything. Well, what inspires you musically? I mean, I think I know kind of art, like, as an actor, you're inspired by just
talent. I listen to a lot. I mean... Like, depending on what I feel, like, angry music, I listen to 50 Cent, Get Rich or Die Trying. I love
Biggie.
Black Moon. I love Harry Connick Jr., you know,
jazz.
When I'm in a different vibe. definitely gospel.
You got some Papa Michigan in your deck?
Some.
I need to.
Okay.
Molly Music. Isaac Reed. You know.
Molly Music. That's our guy. That's her favorite.
You know.
We met him the other. We were in the studio. We saw him get put his whole little thing. We saw him play instruments.
Hey, Molly is so incredible.
Yes.
You know, can I tell my story?
Yes,
my Molly
can.
Music
of course
story.
You can.
So. So, last year R.I.P. my cousin died 4th of July.
Wow.
And he was an incredible guy. Mm-hmm. You know, he died in Costa Rica taking his family on a month-long vacation. And the son got in the currents and in the water, and he went to save his son, and he died. His son lived. And so, he was listening to Molly Music so much. You know, that was his every day. So, my cousin's younger brother was at Target. And parked and was crying, just tears coming down his face, just crying about his brother. A car pulled up next to him, and he looks, and
it's Molly.
He's just crying. Someone knocks on his window, and it's Molly. And he says, "What can I do for you?" He's like, "What?" He said, "What can I do for you, brother?" He said, "I want you to sing at my brother's funeral." He said, "When is it?" He told him when it was. He said, "I'll be there." He came to my cousin's funeral in Temecula, and sung. Came back home with the family and kicked it. And he's part of the family now.
Get out.
Crazy. I took him with us to the Jay-Z Beyonce concert with us. Just, you know, but just amazing. Yeah. The spirit was incredible. So I support him. I bust my gun for him, whatever.
Molly Music. We love him too. Yeah, that was an excellent story. Wow. Okay. Well, rest in peace to your cousin.
Oh, yeah.
That's crazy. Like trying to do that.
RIP. Yeah.
Yeah. So let us know how we can follow you, because we're gonna get into this and then we gotta wrap it up. It went by so fast.
I know, right? Yeah, I gotta bring me back.
Yes.
I'm easy to find on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Dennis L A White at Dennis L A White. And you can go to my website at likeyouknow.org.
Okay, that's your network. I'm coming to that in January.
Come on.
Okay.
Come on. Okay. And so that's how you find me. I'm easy.
Okay. Dennis L.A. White in the house, Beauty and the Beat Radio. We up in here. So let's introduce your artist. You first, your directorial debut.
Yeah. This is my artist, my boy, Anthem Brown for Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
The song, Back to Back, incredible, enjoy it, directed by me.
Mm-hmm.
And shot by Matt Beverly.
Okay, let's get into it. Beauty and the
Beat. Why, oh man, oh man, oh, I'm alone to tell who the greatest, who is known is. This the type of anthem that'll keep you where the flow is. Young blood, fresh boys dance for the show. Why young prince stay watching kings for the throne, yeah. Kings for the glow, nigga, I got a dream. New slaves and new waves to break from the schemes. Kings for the savage, nigga, I got a dream. Monsters out of roses, lining in the streets, yeah. Let's play a boy, don't think with his eyes closed. Mind closed, nigga, I know how the line goes. Yeah, King Kunta be with time froze. Listening to the negro spirit drums. Kumbaya, little nigga. Caught you right before you had finger pull the trigger. Listen, young blood, yeah, I know just where the line goes. Take your hands on suicide before your mind blows. We give what we give. They'll never understand why we live. The words of the wise men stick to me. Everything just started to click to me. Shout out to a king for teaching me how to survive, yeah. From the border, know it's hard to stay alive, yeah. Boy, Ed Brown killing back to back. Back to back. Taking niggas' crowns, goes back to back. Back to back. I guarantee y'all gon' hear it again. Sit back and watch the era of the king begin. Take over, coming, yeah, I'm plotting on the law. Gotta keep these niggas guessing, never know. When I'm coming in, a nigga, when I'm living out. Making addicts from the knowledge dripping from my mouth. No, you can't see me. Your eyes will peep before your ears, just believe it. It's the type of anthem that'll keep you where the flow is. It's the type of sound that'll take you where the kings live. Your boy Ed Brown killing back to back. Ooh, yeah, back to back. Taking niggas' crowns, going back to back. Back to back. Your boy Ed Brown killing back to back. Back to back. Taking
niggas' crowns going back to back. 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 Back to back.
And that was Anthem Brown. Did I get that right? Because I want to look out for him.
Yeah.
I look out straight out of Carolina.
Vietnam.
I like that. So how can we find him? Because we want to, I mean, we know how to find you. How can we find him? Because we like that song. We in here back. We like reminiscing on something. Like, what do you sound like? That
Anthem
sound
Music.
Good. Anthem Music. So look him up.
Yeah.
Okay. Anthem Music. Dennis L.A. White. Papa Michigan just went out the door and it's Beauty and the Beat Radio. We up in here. We about to be up out of here.
No doubt.
No doubt.
I'm loving the pants and everything.
Fair enough.
Mm-hmm.
Fair enough. Why not? All right. Well, thank you, and we out. I appreciate everybody for coming. Beauty and the Beat, though.